Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for that introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to be in this distinguished company here today, and really nice to be back in Dublin. I was here as the guest of the Taoiseach, as his colleague, almost 2 years ago, and had a very great visit at that time. One of the things that we were able to arrange was cooperation between the National Museum here in Dublin and our equivalent, and we hope that we will see the fruits of that coming within a few years with more cooperation between the two museums, because we indeed do have a lot in common as we have moved through history, most of the time as friends, sometimes as enemies. And as you know, there is a lot of Irish blood in the Icelandic population, so the gene pool is somewhat similar, the modern-day researchers tell us. But let me move on to the subject area that I was planning to talk to you today about. It's become a truism, a commonplace and a conventional wisdom that the recession and the economic difficulties that the world is now going through is not paralleled by anything except the Great Depression in recent decades. Some people even go as far back as 1915, say the world has never seen such difficulties economically since 1915, or at least not since the 1930s. And what has happened is truly a global hurricane, affecting not just the big and the rich countries, but also very severely some of the smaller ones and the poorer ones. Africa, for example, is deeply hurt by the crisis because the second-round effects of the economic crisis are reducing their exports, lowering their export prices, and so on and so forth. Now, while the origins of the current crisis are generally tied to events in the United States in the fall of 2007, the so-called subprime lending crisis, it did indeed spread very rapidly as a contagious disease, which is another example to show how interdependent the world has become in economic terms. It spread very quickly to other financial centers, to the UK, continental Europe, and elsewhere. And before we knew, governments all over the place were pouring taxpayer money to solve the problems, to try to bail out particularly different banks and financial institutions. Now, one of the more well-known victims of this crisis, of course, is my own country, Iceland, where the three biggest private banks had outgrown the rest of the economy by a factor of 10, roughly, 10 to 12, depending on what exchange rate you use, within a period of very few years. And they had expanded very aggressively overseas. And these three banks constituted about 85% of the whole financial system in the country. The Icelandic banks were actively operating all over Europe, including the UK and Ireland, in Scandinavia, on the continent, in North America, and the Far East. These banks were run by relatively young, well-educated people. They paid high salaries and taxes, and were generally quite popular in the country, well-liked, and they were growing very rapidly. They were able to hire the best talent around from different disciplines who devised new financial products all the time and were usually a step or two ahead of the financial regulators and the supervisors. I should add that in early 2003, the government, I was finance minister at the time, privatized two of those commercial banks. We have going back, a history of state-owned banks. One of them had been, there were three of them actually, one of them was privatized in the early 90s, and the other big two in 2003. And it is possible that as a result of this, they became more aggressive than they would have been, although that is a hypothesis that may be very hard to prove. Now, I'd like to say that there were two critical outside phenomena that were extremely important in the big and fast expansion of the Icelandic banks. And both of these were really beyond the control of the Icelandic authorities. Number one was the fact that the banks were operating all the time within the common European Union framework for financial markets and institutions. As a member of the European Economic Area, which comprises the European Union, Norway, Iceland, and Liechtenstein, we had introduced into law all the relevant EU directives in this field, which allowed any bank with a license in one country to operate in another country, either through branches or subsidiaries or in doing and pursuing any other kind of banking activity. The rules, for instance, allowed deposit taking overseas, just to name an example. Now, these rules looked quite good on paper, but as it turned out, they were seriously flawed and in some cases outright dangerous, as in the case of the deposit insurance guarantee scheme, which I will mention again later. Now, the number two critical thing in the expansion of the banks was the fact that after 9/11, 2001, US monetary policy was very lax, interest rates historically were low, and easy credit readily available all over the place. And the Icelandic banks, like so many others, took advantage of this, borrowed heavily in the international wholesale markets, and continued to acquire assets such as other banks abroad. This strategy might have been successful, and indeed it was for a while, had it not been for the global financial crisis which came unexpectedly and was not foreseen or predicted by anybody, not even institutions like the IMF, that could hardly see it before it was just upon us. Now, when the liquidity crisis, which began in the year 2007 and moved, got more serious in 2008, when this crisis hit, our banks were not prepared, not well enough prepared, and the government of Iceland or its central bank simply did not have the resources to bail them out. Remember, I mentioned the factor of 10 to 1. The balance sheets of the banks were about 10 times bigger than GDP. So that was a very difficult situation. So the banks were in a very difficult situation already in late summer and early fall 2008. And after the fall of Lehman Brothers, when the interbank market completely closed, in my view, they didn't have a chance after that. So, hence, they collapsed in early October. In the international financial hurricane, the size of the Icelandic banks proved to be fatal. It can be said that the banks were not strong enough to withstand the drought in the global credit markets, but they were too large to be rescued by our treasury or the central bank. The size of the Icelandic banks as a proportion to GDP was unparalleled. Maybe Switzerland comes close, but not many other countries. In a normal economic climate, their size would probably have been a strength, and they would have withstood all sorts of conventional difficulties. But when a massive global recession struck full force, it was their very size that brought them down. So what I've just said now is a broad outline of what actually happened in the advent of the banking crisis in Iceland. Of course, not all of what happened can be blamed on the global financial situation or external factors, but a good bit can. Those things, what happened externally, you might classify as bad luck. There was nothing that we could do about that. Bad luck, as perceived with from an Icelandic viewpoint, and not something that we could directly influence. Other factors, however, can be blamed on both some mistaken government economic policies. I am one of those responsible for that. I've said that publicly. Policies such as ill-timed expansionary tax cuts, but in particular, the element to be blamed here are some bad banking practices by the banks themselves. There was a certain lack of responsibility and caution and too much eagerness to grow and grow. The bad practices, which we are now seeing afterwards, and were not necessarily completely aware of when this was happening, the bad practices included non-prudent lending, cross-ownership among banks, abuse of holding companies, lending to owners and senior management, and the bank's acceptance of their own shares or those of other banks as collateral when financing the purchase of such shares. You can imagine a lot of people lost a lot of money after having borrowed to buy shares in the banks because they became worthless. Now, these practices, as we know, were by no means unique to Iceland. This was becoming an international problem. But in our case, because of the size of the banks relative to the rest of the economy, it was a serious problem. So were the super salaries the bankers paid themselves, which created widespread public resentments. And that certainly is not a unique phenomenon to Iceland. I think even you might have had it here. So this was indeed a multifaceted crisis that we were facing. In fact, it was the most multidimensional challenge that I had ever had to deal with in my public years of public life, with not only the financial components and the fact that we had a collapsing banking system, but also, as a consequence, we had some very important macroeconomic problems to deal with, as well as the political elements, which naturally arose, plus the PR part domestically and abroad, which turned out to be very important. Someone counted and told me that I had done more than 100 interviews with foreign journalists over a period of about 3 months in the wake of all of this. None of us involved had had any experience with this type of crisis management. So no doubt mistakes were made. I have no doubt about that during this course of events. That was probably inevitable. But we were still able to get a number of important things done, as I will continue to outline. In December, our parliament decided, by unanimous consent, to establish a special investigative committee led by a Supreme Court justice to investigate this whole affair and try to determine how this could have happened, what went wrong, and why, who and what is to blame, what could have been done differently. So this investigation is now ongoing. They hope to have a report out by the 1st of November. In a separate act of law, The Parliament set up an office of special prosecutor that will look into and eventually prosecute anyone responsible for illegal activity related to the collapse of the banking system. And unfortunately, early indications are that this office will have plenty of business. Now, when it became clear that all wholesale lending abroad was drying up and that the banks, at least one of the Icelandic banks, would not be able to refinance itself in October when a big loan became due, and contrary to the previous statements that all of the banks were fully financed through 2009, the government had to take some very decisive action. I went on national television in the late afternoon of October the 5th to explain the situation to the nation, and that evening the Parliament passed emergency legislation authorizing our financial supervisory authority to take over banks that could not meet their obligations. This piece of legislation was passed without any dissenting vote, although some MPs abstained. Ultimately, all of the three banks were taken over by the FSA in a matter of 3 days. Each one of them was split up into two entities, the so-called old bank, run by a resolution committee, and a new bank, run by a new management team. The objective was to ensure that domestic banking services would continue as normally as possible and that the average bank customer using a credit card, making withdrawals or deposits, would not see any difference. And this became the function of the new banks, who took over all domestic deposits and certain assets. And this worked out perfectly, actually. The old banks, led by the resolution committees, were supposed to deal with the foreign side of the situation and maximize asset value to the creditors of the original banks. Now, this process is still going on, but in the end, hopefully within a few weeks from now, the new banks will issue bonds that will go to the old banks to cover the assets taken from them, and then the government will recapitalize the new banks, which are now wholly owned by the state, as the former shareholders lost all their shares, as I said earlier. On this basis, the old banks will, over a few years, be able to clear up the situation with all the creditors. Obviously, many creditors will lose substantial amounts on this sad turn of events. But it can also be said that they did not evaluate the risks associated with lending to the Icelandic banks properly. And to some extent, that is the fault of the credit rating agencies who used to give the banks top ratings, some even AAA, for a while, not so long ago. So in my view, the credit rating agencies have been completely discredited in this whole process. Now, for most countries, a full-scale banking crisis is in itself a terrible problem to deal with on its own. But it's not unique to us. Many countries have had to go through banking crises not so long ago. Sweden, Finland, Norway in the 90s. Countries in the Far East. Several countries have had this problem, and it's a well-known phenomenon. But in our case, we found ourselves also in the middle of a very serious international dispute as a result of actions taken by the UK government with respect to the Icelandic banks and the government of Iceland. Not very pleasant, not very helpful, and definitely not very friendly. Now, this has partly to do with the deposit-taking activity of two Icelandic banks in the UK, which was based on the EU directive that I referred to earlier. In this case, the UK Treasury slammed a freezing order on behalf of the UK government on one of the banks, but also, to begin with, on all of the assets of the Icelandic government and its central bank, frozen. This was based on authority provided for in the Anti-Terrorism, Crime and Security Act of 2001. enacted in the wake of the events of 9/11/2001, a piece of legislation that was controversial at the time because it was feared that it could be used in non-terrorist situations like this one. I was on the phone with Chancellor Darling that same day when they did that. And I said to him, Chancellor, you know, we're not terrorists. Well, I know that, he said, whatever else you may be. The action of the UK government caused utter confusion among those trading with Iceland and disrupted the payment system for transactions going in and out of the country for several days. The damage was enormous, and foreign businesses were afraid to deal with Iceland because of the heavy penalties provided for in the Anti-Terrorism Act. In addition, the Icelandic Landsbanki and for a few days also the whole government were listed on Her Majesty's Treasury's website as the recipients of this treatment in the wonderful company of Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and rogue states like the Sudan, North Korea, and others. Supposedly, the reason for this unprecedented action against a small friendly neighbor and ally was fear on the part of the UK government that Iceland would not meet its obligations under the Deposit Insurance Directive that I referred to earlier. Had there been a reason to worry about this, and I really don't think there was a reason, had we talked about it in a proper way, but had there been a reason to worry about this, then certainly the first step before resorting to action like this should have been to initiate urgent and formal talks between the two governments, like all civilized countries do, rather than shoot first and then ask questions. Needless to say, this action injected a lot of bad blood into the situation and made things considerably worse. So in addition to just dealing with a domestic banking crisis, we had this problem on our hands, which was very difficult. Now, the freezing order was finally lifted this last Monday, after the UK government and the Icelandic one came to a provisional agreement on the handling of the deposit guarantee problem, which will in all likelihood anyway be covered by the assets of Landsbanki. Landsbanki was not devoid of assets when it was stopped. It has plenty of assets, and it's estimated that its own assets will cover somewhere between 75% and 95% of the claims involved here. This was always assumed. But if it doesn't cover all of that, or doesn't cover 100%, the idea is that the Icelandic government will back up the rest so that the minimum deposit insurance is covered. Why we needed to be under the provisions of this Anti-Terrorism Act for 8 months to get there is still incomprehensible to me and a lot of other people who have looked at this. Now, another thing with respect to our friends in the UK. The UK Financial Supervisory Authority decided in early October to take over another Icelandic bank, not Landsbanki, but Kaupthing, Singer and Friedlander. Although this bank was incorporated in the UK, it was a subsidiary and not a branch, and it had a banking history in the UK of more than 100 years. Singer and Friedlander is a well-known, or used to be a well-known bank in the UK. This action, taking over this operation, led to the fall of the Kaupthing Bank in Iceland, which was the biggest company in the country, and which all of us had assumed would most likely survive this crisis. And we were so confident, and the central bank was so confident, that on the Tuesday after we passed the emergency legislation, the central bank, with our approval, decided to lend Kaupthing, the biggest loan in the history of the country, 500 million euros, for 4 days to help them bridge a gap that they needed to cover some short-term financing. So, and the collateral was a bank that they owned in Denmark. On a Thursday, on a Tuesday, this was done, was supposed to be repaid on a Friday. Well, the UK intervened on Wednesday, and the bank fell, and this loan has not been repaid yet. And the Central Bank of Iceland is now in possession of this FIH bank in Denmark. All of this was, unfortunately, very unfriendly, and in my view, probably not necessary. And this particular action with respect to Kaupthing is now being reviewed by the courts in England, as the resolution committee of Kaupthing is planning to bring a lawsuit against the UK government and challenge its actions with respect to Kaupthing. And I might add that this action has the full support of the previous government, my government, and also the present one. A similar action with respect to the application of the anti-terrorism legislation was also considered. And we had some very excellent UK lawyers looking at that for us. But it was deemed unlikely to succeed in the courts because of the wide powers given in this legislation and discretionary powers given to the minister involved, the minister, the chancellor of the Exchequer. So, this is what happened in a nutshell. There are books coming out on this now already. They are much longer than what I just said. So I've only given you a very brief version of what happened. But I should also note, like I said before, it was a multidimensional problem. There was the financial situation, getting the banks, making sure that the banks were providing basic services. Then, in addition to that, there were the tremendous macroeconomic consequences of this problem, because immediately the difficulties in the financial sector translated themselves into the real economy as the banks were not able to finance and service businesses and households. What did that mean? Well, it meant that our GDP would fall this year by some 10%. Very dramatic. We thought it was a record until I read the World Economic Outlook from the IMF. Latvia is dropping by 18% this year. Even Germany by some 6%. And the whole world economy is dropping by 2.5 or something like that. The US, something similar. Okay, we are at 10. That, however, because of the fact that we've had such rapid economic growth recently, will bring us back to the level of 2005 or 6 in terms of GDP. But of course, the distribution of the loss is not even. There are a lot of people who have lost a lot. People have lost their share value, their savings, their jobs, and so on and so forth. But this is the average number. In addition to the GDP effect, we have now much more unemployment than we are used to and than we can, I think, live with for any period of time. Unemployment jumped from 1% in September to 9% right now. So the banking people, people in construction industry, and a number of other industries have lost their jobs. And it's a primary objective for all the political parties to get the economy moving and creating new jobs. Inflation became a problem also because of the fact that our exchange rate fell so drastically that the price of imported goods rose sharply, and the inflation level is now between 10 and 11. In other words, the price level is now roughly 11% higher than it was 12 months ago. But all predictions are that it will come down to the target level of 2.5 or even less in the year 2010. The economic impact on the central government finances was also drastic. We have been running surpluses for several years. It was my primary objective as Minister of Finance to lower the government debt. And this was a good idea, because now, when all this happened, the central government was almost free of debt. So it was in a much better position to take on new debt, which is what it has to do to recapitalize the banks, to pay for the deficits that are now coming, to recapitalize, to a certain extent, the central bank, and service other loans that we are taking. So the debt burden of the government will go from very close to zero on a net basis to very close to 100%. But this is sustainable. All of the calculations show that even if we go this high, which is still less than a number of countries are facing in Europe prior to the crisis, we will be able to work our way out of that situation. And a lot of it is domestic debt, which is, of course, a lot easier to deal with than foreign debt. Now, we decided to work with the IMF on solving these problems. And I think that was the only way to go at that time. The IMF have had a mission in Reykjavik now for some time. They have a permanent representative living there. He happens actually to be an old schoolmate of mine from the U.S., just like Francis Jacobs. But they and us, we worked out a program which has basically three objectives. One is to get the banks restructured and going again on a satisfactory basis. Number two is to strengthen and stabilize the currency. We've had to introduce currency controls to shore up the currency. Interest rates are very high for the same reason, now at 12%. Used to be at 18 some months ago. And that's objective number two, the currency. And number three, of course, is the public finances. Fiscal policy, a program to bring the public finances back into balance over a three-year period. And that is really the tough call. That is the tough challenge. And the IMF has not put any conditions on us that are not reasonable. We feel that they are there to help us and not to hurt us. And they are suggesting policies that we probably should have adopted anyway. They are not pursuing policies or making demands that we cannot meet. So this is the macroeconomic picture. There was also the political picture. When you have a crisis like this, you have a coalition government, you have a noisy opposition, and you have a lot of people on the webs, on the blog sites, and in the streets who claim to know better how to do things. Of course, you have something ripe for political change. I would describe it. What happened ultimately at the end of January and the beginning of February was that our coalition partner. We had a two-party coalition. My party, which is the right of center, and the Social Democrats were working together in a grand coalition like in Germany. And we had two-thirds of the seats in parliament. But with the street demonstrations that we had, and that maybe you have seen on television, with the discontent, general discontent that was growing, people were witnessing stuff coming out of the banks, seeing that there had been market manipulation and all kinds of stuff coming out. Of course it was directed at the government, and of course it was directed at the party, the bigger party who had been in office for 18 years. I'm told something similar is going on in Ireland. That was not unexpected. But our coalition partners actually left the government over internal divisions in the government on how to proceed, and formed a government of the left with the Left Green Party. First a minority government, then elections were called in April, and they are now a majority government, and my party is now in the opposition for the first time in many years. And I am no longer in parliament because I resigned or did not run for office for very personal reasons. It was a very dramatic winter, particularly for me and the foreign minister, who was the chairperson of the other party. We both developed difficult medical problems. She had a cancer in her head, which needed to be operated on immediately when she was in New York in the fall. And so she was in and out of her work had to go back to Sweden for more operations, and decided ultimately not to continue. I got a cancer in the esophagus, which is very bad news if it's not detected early, but it was detected early in my case, and I think I'm out of the danger zone by now. I'm one of the 16 out of 100 that actually make it with that kind of a problem. So the doctors tell me. We'll see. So we had a lot of changes, and we had a lot of things happening economically, politically, and personally in the lives of some of us. Now, what is then the future outlook, given all of this that I've told you? Well, I think there are many silver linings in this sky. First of all, we were one of the first countries actually to get hurt, and we were the first modern Western country to actually talk to the IMF, get them on board, and with through cooperation with the IMF, we are also securing formal loan assistance from several other countries, including the Nordic countries, all of the Nordic countries, the Poland, and possibly also Russia, although that's not quite clear yet. This is important because it helps us bolster our foreign reserves. We have borrowed from the IMF already, drawn on a third of the facility that they provided. And we're not using that to finance imports or pay for a deficit on the government accounts. We are just keeping it as reserve money in our foreign currency reserves. Necessary to help the currency, useful, relatively inexpensive, though, and not something that will be spent on current consumption or anything like that. So I believe that we were the first ones to go in. We might be one of the first ones to actually start coming back. And the forecasts say that we will have positive economic growth already next year. Our balance of payments is turning around very rapidly. Of course, the trade balance is in surplus now. Imports are very expensive. Exports are very competitive. But the difficulty is the global recession here, because one of our main export products is aluminum. The price of aluminum has fallen dramatically. So has the price of fish, and so on and so forth. So even if we are pulling ourselves up domestically, we still are dependent on the international marketplace for many of our products. But I do believe that we will now have three basic foundations in our economy for the future. We will, of course, have the fishing industry, which is a stable backbone of the economy, well-managed, well-run, and profitable. It is not a subsidized industry like it is in so many other countries. We will also have a great future in power-intensive industry. We have several aluminium plants. We might have more, or we might have other uses for our abundance of relatively cheap, green, renewable energy, hydro and geothermal. We are already at 80% renewables in our total energy consumption. The objective of the European Union is 20% by the year 2020. So we are way ahead. And I think Ireland is at about maybe 2 or 3% and needs to do a lot of work, for instance, in wind power and so on, if it wants to meet that target. Then, of course, we have tourism, which is growing rapidly, and we have a lot of other smaller type of activity, manufacturing and stuff that can also help help the recovery of the economy. But most of all, most important of all, we have a relatively young population, and we have a well-educated population, people who can adapt quickly. We have a flexible labor force, flexible administration, flexible economy in general. All of this will help. People move easily from one job to another. It's easy and quick for companies to make investment decisions and so on. So I'm optimistic when it comes to this. But then the final point has to do with the lessons to be learned from all of this sad experience. And that is not a unique or an Icelandic problem exclusively. It is a pan-European problem. The European Union will have to do a lot of work on its financial market regulations, on the supervision, and on a number of other things. I've talked about the deposit insurance scheme. Well, that is clearly very faulted. We almost had a total system failure in the banking system. Not quite, but almost. Well, this directive does not provide for what you do in that situation when it's completely obvious that the country concerned cannot meet its so-called obligations under the scheme. And I think there are learned papers within the European Union, including from the Bank of France, suggesting that the scheme as provided for in the directive is not applicable in the case of a system failure or a complete collapse of a banking system in any country. If you are to allow banks to take deposits across borders in another country, they should either do it in subsidiaries and not branches, because the subsidiaries are guaranteed by the host country, the branches are guaranteed by the home country. And if you are going to do this across 27 countries, you cannot rely on the system in any one of them. You must have a joint system, a joint fund, to handle such problems, it seems to me. So that's just one example of what needs to be done. There are, of course, a number of other things that I'm really not the expert to explain to you what they are, but on the European level and then also at a more global level, a lot of work needs to be done. Unfortunately, the world leaders at the G20 meeting in April and the EU leaders, whenever they meet, are seriously tackling these issues. So that's the good news. And then we will have to see how things progress. I am optimistic with respect to my own country. I think we will pull ourselves through. That we have always done that, both with economic crisis and natural catastrophes, which we've had many of throughout the years. So that I'm quite confident of. I'm not so sure if everybody else will, and whether the world economy will be able to recover quickly enough is not really for me to say. But let me just, very briefly, because I know that some of you are quite interested in that question, what does this all mean with respect to Icelandic membership or non-membership of the European Union? Well, maybe I should just mention that question and leave it there. Well, let me then, by way of background, tell you that membership of the European Union has never been a parliamentary election issue. There has been one party, traditionally, in favor of membership. That's the Social Democrats, who were in our coalition. When we formed the coalition in 2007, they did not demand that we have put that on our agenda, and they said, we realize we are in a minority, we'll just leave it at that. Other parties were against or less favorable than the Social Democrats. Now, in this situation, the Social Democrats and some other people have said, well, this would never have happened. This disaster would never have happened had we been members of the European Union. Well, I doubt that. And I can give you examples, like Latvia, who were members of the Union, even though they're not members of the Eurozone. I don't know, I don't know enough about Ireland to pass judgment, but of course you've had a lot of difficulties in spite of your membership of the European Union and the Euro. But in any event, what has happened has given support to the theory of many people that we cannot go on with our own currency, that we need to find a different way. And some people say then, well, okay, we need to join the Union and adopt the Euro. That may take 5 years, maybe even longer, to meet all the criteria and so on. Other people say, well, why don't we adopt the Euro unilaterally, like Montenegro did? But of course they are applying for membership. And the third school of thought is, well, why don't we adopt the American dollar, the US dollar? And there are a lot of ideas floating around in this respect. But the currency issue has now become the prime mover or motor for discussions of the European Union question. Traditionally, most people have been against the European Union because of its fisheries policy. which is wasteful, not successful by any standard, and needs to be revised probably from the very bottom and up. However, we have a good management system. We have a profitable industry. We use the scientists to give us scientific advice on how much to catch of any given species, and we go by their advice. And we've been successful in protecting species, rebuilding up fish stocks that were gone, and so on. But of course, there is always a heavy debate on whether we should do this or do that. But the interesting thing is that we have both the fishermen, the boat owners, and other concerned parties in agreement, in principle, that we should do all this on the basis of the best scientific evidence available. I'm afraid that's not so in the European Union. And of course, fishing is a marginal industry, heavily subsidized by most countries, and therefore it's a very different situation. We are also worried about agriculture, what will happen to agriculture. And people are also worried about the administrative burden for us to join the union. We have such a very small central administration, only a few hundred people. What will that do? And also, people are not particularly eager, at least not in the current situation, to join the union and have to pay, be a net contributor into the system, because that we would definitely be, even after the banking shock. So there are a number of issues there, but the current situation is the following. The Social Democrats formed a government with the Left Green, who have always been against membership. They could not agree on how to handle the issue, so they brought a proposal to Parliament and said, okay, we'll leave it to Parliament to decide what the next step should be. Social Democrats want to apply for membership as soon as possible. The Left Greens generally no, although some of them are now more positive. And they said, okay, Parliament must decide, which really means that the opposition must decide. This is unusual, to say the least. And this is now being dealt with in parliamentary committees, and I don't know what the result will be. The result might be some kind of a compromise to say, okay, let's apply and let's see what's in that bag. Let's just see if we're getting any goodies that we don't know about from membership, and if we're not getting an acceptable solution with respect to fisheries, we can always say no in a referendum. That is one way of thinking. My party, which has been opposed, but is now looking at it perhaps a little differently, has said, right, if we are going to apply for membership and see what's in that bag, let's have two referenda. First, on whether or not we should apply, and then a second one at the end of the negotiations, we'll vote again on the final result. So it's a pretty open question at the moment. Nobody knows what will happen. But at least this issue, possible membership in the European Union, is much more alive than it's ever been before. And many people also say it's a question that we need to get out of the way. We can't continue discussing this for years and years. So either we apply and accept, then we'll have to live with that. Or we apply and say no, and then it's gone. So it's quite interesting to follow, but we really don't know what the outcome will be. I think I've gone way over time, haven't I?
You've kept people fascinated.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much. I'll leave it here.